Hey, this is Dominic, and this is your home for the cutting-edge conversations on optimizing your personal performance, lighting up your sex life, and living a purpose-driven life of your own design.
These are the topics that Dominic and I have both struggled with in our own lives and still don't always get right. This is Bryan. Welcome to the Great Man Podcast.
Back in September of 2020, we put a strong stake in the ground around building this global great man community. That was the point in time where I decided to close off all my corporate business and to do this work 100% of the time. And one of the most inspiring developments I've seen unfolding over these last 9 months is how many men are stepping forward, expressing the desire to lead groups of men in their lives. Whether that takes the form of leading your own men's group, mentoring men in the workplace, or simply becoming a better leader of all genders in an area of life that's important to you, this episode has something in store for you. In today's episode, Bryan steps into the interview role and he interviews me about my six-year journey from hosting my very first men's group meeting, where I just wanted to do one meeting once, to where I am today, having committed my entire life for the rest of my life to leading men. How I overcame those nagging doubts in my mind of, who the hell am I to be leading other groups of men? Especially these guys were my friends a few moments ago, and now I'm standing here on a pedestal. What would these guys have to learn from me? Why would these guys listen to me? How I overcame that. I know that's a big one for many of you guys. How to handle those intense emotional situations that men bring to you that you've never seen or dealt with before or have any experience dealing with. How you don't need to know the answers, why you don't need to solve the problem, and how to handle those situations so that person feels safe. How to begin your first steps on the journey of bringing groups of men together. But this is one of the most critical steps, is how and why you need to build your inner circle, your nucleus of men who are ride or die, who are standing alongside of you, who can lead with you. So it's not just you on your own. That is a lesson I wish I would have learned at the very beginning. How to harness the power and the talents of the men in your group to raise them up while simultaneously taking the weight off of your shoulders. This is one of the other things I wish I would have learned early on, is if you can tap into the power and the talents and the skills of the men who are in your group, it takes a lot of the weight off your shoulders. How to design the content and the structure and the flow of those particular group meetings. And then finally, the many rewards of leading other men, including how your deepest inner work will often come from leading others. Enjoy today's episode of How to Become a Leader of Men.
Dominic, here we are. Just the two of us.
Yeah. It's been a while, man.
It's been a while. It has been a while. And I'm excited to have this conversation because we just got off a couple weeks ago our Austin retreat. And yeah.
Yeah. Still flying high.
And there's a lot that came up for me during that retreat. And one of those things is something that I've been struggling with for a little while. And it's not been one of those life holding me down sort of struggles, but it's been that little tickling in the back of my mind for the last 12 to 18 months or so. And it's the topic around leading. I've been feeling a strong resistance to leading. That's not just in men's group. It's not just on this podcast. It's in my relationship. It's in my business. I've just been feeling this resistance to lead. One of the breakthroughs that I had in Austin is I got a chance to lead a group.
Yeah.
And it felt natural and it felt like high impact for myself and for those involved.
Let's be very clear. The feedback was you absolutely killed it. And they said you were masterful and the men's lives who you dug into changed as a result of it. So let's not sell yourself short here. Okay, buddy.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that. And there was also moments in Austin that I was part of where I was so happy to not be leading. And so now I've been sitting shotgun here on this podcast for almost 2 years. I've been sitting shotgun on some of these men's retreats with you and co-hosting them with you. And I've seen how you've led men And today I wanted to get into what is it like? What is it like to lead a mastermind of 21 high-powered, very successful men? Yeah. Because the moment that I'm thinking about in Austin is we were in a sharing circle. A man would get up in the middle and speak from his heart, speak his truth. And there were some really hard topics brought up, life-changing, altering topics. I was happy in those moments that I didn't have to stand up and work with that man or those men.
Yep.
And I remember my mind going, holy shit, I'm glad this is Dominic doing this. And so I want to dive in today, man. Like, let's just start really open.
Yeah.
What is it like to be on the line, the leader of a group of men who are leaders in their lives?
First of all, man, I have to give you such a big blast of gratitude for bringing this conversation to us, because I had come with a totally different topic that we were going to be talking about today. And then, you know, right before we hit record, you're like, hey, do you have something, a topic that you want to hit? Because I just dropped into meditation and there was this idea that came up when you expressed to me that you want to do this interview on what it's like leading men. It just hit me like, ooh, that's the route we got to take. And I wanted to share that for our men, because I used to be a guy who was like so rigid, so structured. Here's the game plan. Let's execute it. And I was so closed off to like inspiration when it's like right there in front of us. And you came with this beautiful idea through meditation that allowed us to actually have this conversation, which I know is going to be powerful for our guys. So thank you for that, man. To answer your question, you know, what's it like leading men? The present day answer is it's the most rewarding thing I've ever done in my life. I would say the answers leading up to this point over the previous like 6 or 7 years, as I've gotten to this point where I first started leading men, is the most terrifying endeavor I've ever been on. Like, there has been nothing scarier for me than to step forward and to position myself as a leader of men, and not just any men. We're talking about accomplished men, men of faith, men of worldly talents and travels and abilities and experiences. These guys aren't slouches, man. Like, these are like highest performing guys in their fields, guys who have experienced some of the toughest experiences of life. To step forward and to have the audacity to say, I've got something, I've got a perspective that can help you, that was an edge for me.
What does that edge sound like in your head?
Oh, like back in the day, the edge. Okay, so let's rewind tape to the first time where I actually stepped forward and like positioned myself in the space. I was working with John O'Connor, who was my coach. He could see that like I had been on this inner work journey for 3 or 4 years. I'd kind of gotten as much as I was going to get, or I guess the law of diminishing returns of doing my own inner work had started to kick in. And the next level was me stepping up and teaching it to others. So he said, Dom, like, you need to have a men's group at your house. Invite like, you know, 7 to 10 guys over, create a conversation, facilitate it. And the idea of, in my head, right? What does it sound like in my head? Who the fuck am I? Who the fuck am I? To like, 1 minute, these guys I'm drinking buddies with, and we're, you know, we're joking around, we're talking about the stupid shit we did. And now I'm supposed to step on a pedestal and be like, hey guys, I have some wisdom and some perspective that you don't. There was a million reasons why my mind like tried to talk me out of it, because I feared making the invitations. I feared no one showing up. I feared making the invitation and someone being like, why are you doing this? Like, what am I going to learn from you? You know, like all of those things. So yeah, that's how it started, man. And it was terrifying.
What's the evidence been along the path? First of all, the group that you had at your house, what year was that?
That had to be like, let's see, it started before I left financial services. So I left like 5 years ago. So it must have been like 6 years ago, maybe 7. But I think probably 6 years ago, I had my first men's group at the house. And I think you were there for that first one, right?
Yeah. I was. Yeah.
Do you remember what your experience was at that?
Yeah, you didn't say anything. It was great. You had other really smart people there. Mm-hmm. Honestly, though, you played really great host mode, right? And you, of course, said a few things, but you had a couple people there to support you. And John O'Connor was one of those.
That's right.
Alexa Martinez was one of those. And on your first men's retreat that you did, you also had really great support structure. John O'Connor was there.
Corey Mascara.
Corey Mascara was
talking about the dream team.
Right. Yeah. These guys were rock stars. And just so the audience knows here, like, John O'Connor, if you look him up, right, he doesn't blast stuff on social media, but he is top of the top when it comes to coaching and specific to men's work, right? Works with every man, does his own work. Like, this guy's a legend. So you had called in some real support along this journey. But now where I see you, whether it's leading virtual masterminds or leading men in Austin or Colorado, like, you're the guy. Those support structures aren't there. When did you get comfortable with that? How did you get there?
You know, like, even hearing you say you're the guy is still something that I'm learning to embrace. I mean, it has been a long journey to go from who the hell am I to, like, embracing the fact that I am the reason why these men are here, and to hold that with humility and also ownership that, like, I've done the work. I've earned this position that I've stepped into. My coach now, his name is David Waldus. He's been on the show. He was like, Dominic, you have to realize that you are now the show. Like, the people are coming to see you. And it's even affected, like, how we do episodes on the show. It's every other podcast is out there figuring out how you get the best guests in the world. And the way I look at it is, like, we've got the magic right here. You know, like, you and me, and we've got Keith, the men from our men's group. Like, so the process for me, taking off the training wheels of being supported, right? 4 years ago, ran the first men's retreat, which is where John O'Connor and Corey Mascara and I led that retreat. It was your first men's retreat at the Racebook Lodge in Sheffield, Massachusetts. That proved to me, that was the step I needed to take, that I could design a retreat. I could invite men to the retreat. I could get men to pay for a retreat, and I could create wild success stories, you know, so that it wasn't just getting that. I mean, there's a lot of those things that kind of, like, all those dominoes need to fall around getting men to come, getting men to have a great experience, getting men to pay for it. And once that box was checked, it was like, okay, the next level up is I'm not going to need that level of support. I don't want to rely on these other coaches. I want to be able to do it myself. And it took a couple of more years, but we did that next retreat in Black Hawk, Colorado, where you played a different role. You were support, you know, like, you helped to run that retreat, but it was a very different kind of, like, 90% of the weight fell on my shoulders, right? And you had never led anything, like, around, you know, men's work before. So it was really, like, your first opportunity to step up, whereas, according to John, had done that for their lives. So it was a new level of, how can I put you in a position where you would be successful? And when that retreat happened, and then we created unbelievable experiences, testimonials that were raving, then the next step was, can I do that not just for 3 days, but can I do that for a year? And the next step up for that was a year-long mastermind, which the idea was birthed in late 2019, and we kicked it off in March of 2020.
I want to talk about this idea of support. And I know in the corporate space, people are often asking and spend a lot of money around, how do I put the right team together? And so while you don't have the other leaders like a Corey Mascaro or a John O'Connor as part of these masterminds or as part of these retreats, you have done an unbelievable job of seeing something in another man to help support you in what you're developing. So for anybody listening that doesn't know, Dominic has a group of what he calls anchors. This is four guys that we get together outside of any other meetings at least once a month, sometimes more than that, if we've got an event coming up, to help you co-create. And I know that you do this with guys in the Facebook group and in the Digital Mastermind as well. I know we have a magician that you reach out to. You have pastors that you reach out to. And so you have created this universe of talented freaking dudes to help support you. And I got to ask, like, these are not paid positions. These are not like, let's build my corporate structure here. Like, these are guys that are willing and able and great at providing this. How have you done that? How have you put this dream team together?
Yeah, man, there's a lot of questions in there, and they're all beautiful. So the first thing I'll start with, whenever you hear me say, stop lone wolfing your life, or lone wolves eventually starve, it's not just to call you forward to stop doing life on your own, because personal development on your own is slow, shallow, and incomplete. It's also a reminder for me. You know, I was the guy who lone wolfed his life. I felt like I had to put everything on my shoulders. I felt like I had to create everything. I felt like when I ran a retreat that all of the work, all the design, like, everything was on my shoulders. And I realized if I wanted to play the long game and I wanted to feel energizing, that it had to be done differently. So what I started to recognize was that what gave me confidence in launching a men's group or launching a retreat or launching a mastermind was I had to look for who are my first one, two, or three ride or dies. Like, who are the men who are like, I'm in the foxhole with you. I want to build this. Let's go. You've always been one of those guys. Keith Bracci's been one of those guys. Mark Melvin, Michael Young. Those are all the anchors that we're talking about. And as soon as I knew that I had yeses from you guys, that then becomes like this nucleus, this magnetic core strength. And instead of it just being like some dude like Dominic, who's, yeah, very interested in this stuff, there's a social proof that comes from, whoa, it's not just Dominic, but it's Dominic and Bryan. And Dominic, Bryan's a pretty cool guy. Wow, Mark's really holy shit, Michael Young's an inspired. Keith Bracci's pretty awesome. All these guys are committed to a cause. Then I have to do far less convincing or far, you know what I mean? It's just like they see that and they're like, whoa, who are these group of really powerful guys? Can I be a part of that? The second part of your question is, how do you get these guys to do it for free, right? Because like you guys are all here, like not getting paid for this work. And the bottom line is if you can offer a man an opportunity to fall in love with himself, to be amazed by what he's capable of, to give him a new lease on his life, to feel like he's building something of meaning and significance, to feel a sense of community, that he's actually creating a legacy. This is all the shit that men are looking for in their lives, whether they know it or not. And most guys will never find it. So when guys come here and they realize that every single day that they spend with us, they're getting smarter, they're getting better, their love lives are growing deeper, their careers are exploding, their network of men, the relationships they have, they feel like billionaires, you know, in terms of relationships. There's not a price tag you can put. Guys pay lots and lots of fucking money and travel all over the place and take on big jobs because they think that that's what's going to give them. And it's here now. So that's how it gets done.
How do you see that? How do you know a guy is going to be a ride or die?
There's a hunger that he shows up to the table with. A hunger, a tenacity. There's also a certain level of surrender that he shows up with. And surrender is like this knowing that his way on his own hasn't worked. Or has worked in some regards, but hasn't worked the way that he wants it to. And he feels that there's an answer that's here for him. A perfect example is like a Mark Melvin. You know, Mark, when he came to the Black Hawk retreat 2 years ago, corporate attorney, very successful in his work, very esteemed in his field. And he found an extraordinary passion for yoga and for mindfulness as a result of kind of healing some wounds, some traumas, some problematic issues with drinking. And he had kind of gone through his own individual journey with that. But he was looking for more community. He wanted to be surrounded by other guys who were doing the same thing. He'd kind of done that on his own and with his partner, Kara. And so what I saw in him was this tenacity to want to share what he had learned with others from his heart. And he wanted to build something, but he didn't have a place to do that. So I fed him. One of the things I love to do, and this is going to be something really important for men who are looking at starting other men's groups, is look at what your men are hungry for and then feed them that. And you have to get really specific with each man. You need to know like what his tastes are. And for Mark, he wanted to teach. He wanted to bring his skills of meditation and yoga to other men. And when I put him in those positions, he thrived. The other guys loved him and he started to recognize he has power. And so now he's a pillar of our community.
There's two things that are coming to me in this part of the conversation, Dominic. The first one is provide opportunity. I can speak from my experience here, whether it's been the discerning dick getting up on a stage and talking, or whether it's been this podcast, right? Whether it's been just in Austin, like leading that group of circle of men, that is such a powerful and seductive opportunity. So having those and being able to jam on places like this, it's really synergistic. It makes me want to come closer to this and to you, right? When we have those opportunities. So that's one piece. The second piece is, and you haven't hit this yet, because I don't think that you're totally aware of it, but something that I've noticed over the years with you is that you're not just a great leader, but you're also a huge fan. And so whether it's a Mark Melvin, whether it's a Sam from Livin, whether it was me and my first company, like you're the first to wear the t-shirt, you're the first to promote it, you're the first to tell an amazing story, right, about that human. We did a podcast maybe a month ago now where I told in part of the story of my engagement. And hearing you do the recording that you do, the intro to that, I felt edified. I felt like, man, I don't feel like a superhero every day, but hearing you speak about me made me feel like a superhero. So yes, you're leading, but it's reciprocal too. And that's something that you do an amazing job of is kind of the honoring and the seeing, right? Seeing someone.
Thank you for that. And you have shared that with me before. So like you actually did turn me on to that awareness. I didn't realize that that's how I showed up. But part of that is like my parents and their upbringing, they've always cheered me on in that way. And like they taught me how to do that. The other part of it is intentional, because in King, Warrior, Magician, Lover, they talk about one of the key responsibilities, one of the duties of the king is to provide blessings to those in his kingdom. And blessings means seeing the people in your kingdom and recognizing them for their gifts. And if a man is unseen, then he is wounded. He is harmed, right? And so when I think about the men that are in our communities, like I get to see each and every one of their gifts. And I love to call that forward. I love to cheer them on. I love, it's interesting when I was telling the story about Mark and how he kind of comes up with this hunger, this tenacity of wanting to teach, you bring that too. And there's also times where like you talked how you started with this resistance to lead. And so sometimes like I see it, you're not asking for it, but like I see it and then I put you in that position and every time you thrive, you know? And so part of my job is to help you see the things inside of you that you don't see. And then to put you in that, to help you walk towards that edge, because we always talk about one of our key principles is living out over your edge in everything you do. And my job is to support you so you don't fall. And then when that happens and you get to see like the seminar or the workshop that you ran at the Mastermind Immersion 2 weeks ago, like when you did it with such power, with such great feedback, you got a chance to see like, wow, I'm kind of impressed by myself. Like I can do more of that, right? And sometimes it's just the need to be put in that position so that you can recognize you're ready.
Where are the edges for you right now? So you don't have a Dominic kind of putting you into those positions that you're maybe not quite ready for. What are those edges for you right now?
The edges are, I would say the biggest edge is learning how to train other leaders up and then step back and let them do the work, let them lead some of the work that's happening inside of our communities where I'm not the one who's doing all of the facilitation and all the counseling and everything. So for example, in the Digital Mastermind, we have 30 men who are around the world doing inner work. They're on a subscription basis. You know, many of the guys are in for a year. And what I've realized is that with those 30 men, there's no way I can create the level of intimacy and connection that they need if I'm always the one just like sitting on a webinar doing the 1-to-30 type thing. These guys need more involved oversight. And so one of the things that I'm now doing is I've established a leadership council of 6 men inside the Digital Mastermind. These are guys who have emerged as leaders who have been present, want to do the work. And I'm training them up in our protocol for learning how to develop emotional mastery, right? Like feel a feeling, name a feeling, that kind of stuff. And learning how to hold space and learning how to run men's group meetings without me there. That's an edge for me to like take my hands off the reins, but if we're ever going to hit 10 million men, this is how it has to go down. And so the edge for me is how do I infuse enough of my energy and my focus so that it like is felt all the way, you know, throughout the ranks, while at the same time staying big picture enough so that like I can remain being the lighthouse and broadcasting so that like the next round of men can find us.
It sounds like a great way to amplify.
Yeah. Definitely.
Scale. 10 million men isn't going to happen with just one seat.
No
right?
way.
So I want to take us to, we've talked a lot about the people and what it's like to lead in that way. But there's also another component to what you do, which is around the design and designing, whether it's a webinar or designing an experience like what we just went through in Austin. Something I've noticed in you is if we look back 3-4 years ago, it's a 3-day event. Had its blocks. It had, okay, from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock, we're doing this. From 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock, we're doing this. And this is how it's going to go. And what I was shocked by in both Colorado and Austin is that there's a lot more freewheeling, but enough structure to make sure we hit what's important. I know you've asked myself or the anchor several times along the way, hey, what do you guys think? But you seem to have a pretty good design in your mind when it comes to these events.
Yeah.
So talk to us about how do you make the decisions? Like, how do we enter a guy into the space? How do we, like, are we going to do a sharing circle or are we going to like sit around the fire? What does that design process look like for you?
This is really important, man. And I'm thinking of all the men who have reached out who are talking about starting men's groups and not knowing, like, how do I come up with a topic? Or I want to be a speaker. How do I come up with an idea? I want to run a workshop. How do I do this? How do I design it? To really do this like beautiful question justice, I kind of have to go deep in this answer, Bry, which is many years ago when I was still in the corporate space and starting to do some like keynote speaking, I didn't have the confidence, you know, to step on a stage and like not have every word scripted. Like for me, when I was doing speeches, I literally had to write down every single, my very first keynote speech that I got hired for, it was for Paychecks, the payroll company. I was still in corporate. I think this was 6 years ago. It took me 40 hours of design work to put together a 1 hour keynote speech that was above average, you know, and I got paid $1,000 for it. And at that point, I'd already made the decision that I was going to be leaving the corporate space to start my own business. And I was like, holy shit, there is no way that this is sustainable. There's no way that not only was it not fun in the design process, it was way too inefficient. And yes, the speech felt good. I got good reviews afterwards, but that like minuscule payoff compared to how much treacherous work there was involved, I was like, I have to find a better way of doing this. So I made this commitment to myself to say, I am going to figure out how the design and the execution is going to be like fun, play, that it's going to be spontaneous, that I can actually rely on my presence and my instinct and what feels good in the moment. And I realized that's going to be a long fucking journey because I just spent 15 years in financial services learning how to craft every word, dry run everything, think about all the contingency plans, you know, whittle down every. And so I had to unlearn all of that. So let's go to that very first, the retreat that we did 4 years ago at the Racebrook Lodge that I had with John O'Connor and Corey Mascara. The idea of having you guys there for 3 days, there's a lot of time over that period. And I was terrified that I was going to run out of stuff to say and to do. That was one of the reasons why I brought in John and Corey. It was like, I don't know if I have enough in my arrows in my quiver to teach these guys. One of the things that I wish someone would have taught me back then that I want the men who are listening here, who are leaders, is you don't have to teach as much as you think. You just have to learn how to be a good facilitator. So for example, if I have a 2 hour block of time, all I really need to do is come in with like 10 or 15 minutes of thoughtful research on a topic around, let's just say if we're talking about anger, I just need to have 10 good minutes of anger talk, a story from my past about when I'd expressed anger in a way that caused negative implications for me, maybe one piece of research on anger, you know, by some anger expert, read a book on anger, whatever it is, and drop that nugget in, and then heat up the space and then ask men to share their stories about anger and then to get creative about it. And all I need to do then for the next hour and 50 minutes is ask really thoughtful questions and to bring other men in the conversation. Like that is a way of being able to kind of take that space and make it much easier. But when I looked at that 3 day experience, it was like I had to have everything mapped out because I didn't have the experience running a retreat like that. And that gave me a sense of comfort knowing like what was going to happen. But if you fast forward to today, man, now that I have done so much work, we have done so much work on our hearts. Now the design doesn't just come from the head. It comes from the heart. The heart allows me to feel what's happening in the present moment. So when it comes to designing a 3 day Austin, Texas retreat for 20 guys who have high expectations around what they're going to experience, I now, because I'm no longer worried about proving myself to the group, like not having that, it's like now instead of worrying about how to prove myself to the group, it's like, how do I create magic for this group? I have a structure of like where I think the start and the end is going to go. I always know exactly how the beginning is going to happen. That's the thing. I always know how I'm going to kick things off, and I'm meticulous around designing something magical for the start. But once that happens, I don't know what kind of magic is going to unfold from there. In the terms of our retreat, like, we opened the sharing circle where four men on the first day stepped up and shared extraordinarily painful things going on in their lives. And from that place, I can't have something that's going to be stacked on top of that that has no congruency with the energy of what just came up. I have to be able to adjust and adapt. But because, like, I've got you guys, the anchors, because I've now got that ability to be thoughtful and heart-centered and to see what's present, then I can just go base to base. And that's been liberating as fuck.
You're answering this question with a huge smile on your face. And I think that comes through when it comes to experiencing what those events are. I know that you and I were, in a Jeep maybe 2 hours before all the men were starting to arrive in Austin. And we were picking up supplies and bringing them over to the house. And I was shocked at how relaxed you were.
Yeah.
Because I was like, man, if I had 20 guys that on my shoulders have to, and not just entertain, but like reach breakthrough moments, I don't know what I would be doing, meditating or worrying or taking notes or whatever. And you just, you felt so breezy. Like, you felt like, great, this is what's going to happen. Here's how it's going
to
go.
It was a long road to feeling that way. And of course I had energy inside of me, but you just made me think about in 2017, I think it was January, I was given a keynote speech for Lincoln Financial Group at their national sales conference, 300 people. And before keynote speeches, the day of and the night before, I used to get so worked up that I couldn't sleep well at night. And the next day, my energy was so erratic that the hours leading up to it, I would exhaust myself before getting on stage. And so I used to have to pound a 4-hour energy before I went on stage to get my energy back because it had been like so dissipated. And I watched myself on stage now when I spoke 4 years ago, and I'm technically sound. Like, I deliver a crisp and eloquent speech, but it's missing the heart. Like, you can see that I'm not at ease when I'm on stage. I maybe have a commanding presence, but it's not at ease. There's not a flow. I just always remember saying, I'm going to find a way. I'm going to find a way. Because when I take the stage, or when the mastermind comes, and like, this was when the 20 guys showed up in Austin, Texas, like, one of the kickoffs was bringing them around in a circle and delivering a speech to them about how we had waited 428 days to get together and how this was a special moment that is only going to be here once in our lifetimes. And that speech in the past, I would have constructed, I would have written it out, I would have memorized it and then delivered it. Instead, I said, I have a few ideas, I have a few thoughts that have come to me, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to stand in the middle of that circle, I'm going to look at these men, and I'm going to allow the feelings that arise to drive what I'm saying. And Bri, like, that was me transcending like a previous ceiling to know that I have that ability now. And then the rest of the weekend, I mean, you've even referenced this a few times. You're like, yeah, dude, like the ability to step in and do these monologues, that was not fully there before this past Austin retreat. And I was finally ready for it, man. And that feels really, really rewarding.
Those intro sessions or those monologues prior to doing some sort of experience together, chills on the skin, ball tingling, as we like to call it. And that doesn't come from a pre-recording. That doesn't come from a written piece of paper. And that can be felt. I felt it for sure. You have this mantra when you're designing of like, this is going to be fun. This isn't going to be the 40 hours of hard work for that 1 hour and little payoff. This is going to be fun. I imagine inevitably you hit a point like, this isn't fun. Like, this is feeling not fun, or this is feeling overwhelming. What do you do in those moments?
I remember reading Metallica's autobiography. I can't remember if I've shared this on the podcast. I know I've shared this with you, but Metallica, one of the most legendary bands of all time, who are great to their fans. But in the biography, it's a biography, I think, they said that, make no mistake, even though Metallica loves their fans, they wrote their music for Metallica first. And if they weren't enthralled or pumped or inspired by their own music, they would not bring it out. they wouldn't listen to their fans, right? Like they wouldn't say, what do you guys want? And then we'll design that. They didn't like Steve Jobs. You know, it's not my customer's job to know what it is that they want. Like it's my job to like to feel inspiration. And I believe the greatest creators are inspired first. The magician that you referenced before, who comes from a long line of magicians in Italy, who I've developed this great relationship with, he says that when he creates from a place of, if I'm not fascinated by what I'm diving into and what I'm creating, how could my audience ever be fascinated? So he will put himself into these states where he's fascinated or in tears. And only then does he create, because as a magician, your bar is really high. If you don't fascinate your audience, you have failed. So he has the bar really high for his creative state of being. And that has really like helped me to step into like, what state am I creating from? So like when it comes to the design, if I'm feeling bored by the topic or the concept, then I trash it and I go back to, what would make my balls tingle?
that's always the question to ask. Yeah. What would make my balls tingle? Good. Okay. So I want to take us back to the moment that we opened this podcast with. We're in Austin. We're in a circle. A guy gets up and shares something really deep, something new, something that none of the guys, even though we had been together for 429 days at that point, we hadn't heard before. And these guys were in a different level. You're up. They get done sharing. What are you feeling in that moment?
So we have some permission to share the high level topics, obviously not the men themselves. But you know what Bryan's talking about is there'd be a man who come to the middle of the circle and share about his infidelity that he'd never spoken about before. A man coming to the middle of the circle and sharing about sexual abuse that he experienced as a child that he had just started to realize was a part of his history that had been blacked out in his mind. And, you know, you're talking about a few other examples of really intense shit that is now in the middle of the circle. And I'm the one standing there and it's my responsibility to meet that man's, the gravity, the intensity of that man's emotion and to let him know it's okay. And so, yeah, what Bryan, what you're saying is like, you know, there's these moments where that happens. You're like, I'm glad that Dominic's in there and not me. Right. And some of these are situations that I've been in before. I've held some intense situations with respect to sexual abuse, with respect to infidelity, but it's always new in some degree. And there's always a level of, and I need you to hear this. I need every man who's potentially stepping into a leadership responsibility or running a men's group. There is always that level of, I have no fucking clue what to do or what to say in this moment. Like there's always that potential and possibility that's there. And John O'Connor was the first one who voiced that to me. He still experiences that, even though he's been running these kinds of things for men for 15, 20 years now. There's always going to be a moment that you've never encountered before. So when some guy comes, like one of the men comes to the middle of the group and shares something that intense, the most important thing that I do is I ground my feet into the floor. I find my breath and I look at this man in the eyes and I want to let him know that he's not alone. I've got you, brother. I want him to feel that it's like we are here together. And this next step, this is what we are training in the Digital Mastermind and the things that we've been training in the masterminds as well, is this protocol around developing emotional mastery. You've heard us talk about it around emotional fluency, but I like the term emotional mastery, the ability to feel a feeling, name a feeling, be with that feeling, right? Not be triggered by it or like commanded by it, be with that feeling, express that feeling, and then shift that feeling if desired. What that does is it completely alleviates the burden from me to have to fix it or solve this problem, right? In those situations where someone's just coming to grips with the fact that they've been sexually abused, there's zero chance you're going to fix that in that moment. There's work that needs to be done that'll take time, modalities, space, etc. So when I no longer have to come up with a solution, when I no longer have to give advice or fix anything, all of which could be most likely like could antagonize the situation anyway, then it actually allows me to say, what are you feeling right now? Usually a man in those situations is up in his head or he's ungrounded. So all I need to do is say, hey, brother, this is what I'm feeling from you. I feel anger. I can reflect to him what he may be transmitting, because he doesn't know where he's at. There's chaos going on inside of him. So all I need to do in that moment, let him know that I'm in the foxhole with him. Get him back into his body, help him ground. Reflect what I see him, you know, transmitting and feel from him. Get curious, you know, like, what's going on right now? What do you need right now? What would you like to express right now? Should we get on the floor together? Should we let out a scream together? Those kinds of things. And you saw me do this with our group too, is I'll turn to the men who are sitting around in the circle and I'll be like, is any man here getting a particular hit that he wants to share? And let me remind you, we are not giving any man advice, right? We're not giving advice at this point. All we're giving is, and I very explicitly create the parameters with which a man can share to the middle, because that's a very sensitive situation. And I still need to maintain control and hold a safe container for the man who's cracked open in the middle.
Do those moments still pop up where, like, I want the solve, I want the breakthrough, I want this man to experience what he can fully be for you?
100%. A great example was, and we talked about this on the episode with you, me, and Keith, where there was a man who was in the middle of the circle, and I'd spent like 40 minutes on this guy, kind of going down a path with him, trying to work on something that has been this boulder he's been carrying around, a metaphorical emotional boulder he's been carrying around in his life. And for 40 minutes, I helped him to make some progress, but I could feel that, like, he was still holding on to a lot of the same emotion. There wasn't a quote solution that had been arrived at. And I started to feel like I'm failing him. And so, like, that still comes up, you know, even as much as I've done this. But what ended up happening was, because the space had been created in a way where the men who were sitting around the circle knew that they could provide insight in a very particular way, that's when Keith jumped in, and that's when Brad Barrett jumped in, created these amazing magical moments that allowed this man to break through. And I look at that as I did contribute to that, because I set the space up for those guys to be so intently listening, but also to know they had the permission and to do so in the sharing in the appropriate way. That was absolutely a part of my contribution. It just didn't happen the way it typically does, which is like, I'm the one creating that breakthrough. And that has also been a great lesson learned, is to release the ego of I have to be the one, and to be just as thrilled when it's like some other guy in the group coming in with a dynamite drop in that creates the magic.
This seems like such a meta experience, because here we are all doing the inner work together, yet to do that inner work, we have to show up and we're doing it at the same time, right? Like, we're talking about it and we're doing it at the exact same time.
Always.
So whether it's you grounding prior to talking to somebody in the middle of the circle that had just shared something, or you letting go of that, the egoic must solve in the moment, that's all in real time, right? It's happening in real time. And I know you referenced this already, but this is the work, right? This is why we practice, why we do what we do, so that we can show up in these moments with our colleagues, with our spouses, or people that we have relationships with. And so it does feel like such a meta experience to be practicing it and doing it all at the same time.
It's the best work you can imagine, man. You and I were talking before we hit record about, like, looking for the alignments in life that make life easier, that also, like, create this network, this amplification effect of, like, feeling in your greatest energy. And if you can create helping another man do his work while also getting the benefit of doing my work at the same time, that's where really magic happens. Those opportunities for alignment are everywhere. We have to look for them.
I want to bring us to something that happened towards the end of the retreat that I, like a fly on the wall, had the opportunity to watch and happened to have the camera running also. There was a man in the retreat that had gone through something really big. It's something that he's been working on for a long time that we are all aware of.
You can share what that was. He said you can share what that was.
Okay. So a man in our group has been struggling with alcohol and what role alcohol has played in his life. And he's had a couple of starts and stops with alcohol, and he just finished a massive program. And that program finished with him writing a letter, a goodbye letter to alcohol. And so he read this goodbye letter to us, to the entire group of men, and then he burned it in the fire that was in the middle between us. And so he did that. And that was both funny and emotional and relatable. And so after it was over, Dom, you came up to embrace him, to show him that support. And dude, he just hung on to you. And I don't know, like the capture, I couldn't hear it and the camera couldn't capture exactly what he was saying. But I could feel, I could see that this man would not be the same without you, without going through this experience, without this group of men that's around him. And there was so much gratitude there. I'm curious, as a leader, as somebody that is setting up this space, what does that feel like?
I'm getting tears in my eyes thinking about that moment again, because what he said to me after we embraced and he pulled me back to look me in the eyes, he was like, "You are changing lives. You changed my life." And he goes, "I will do whatever it takes to help you hit that 10 million men." And for me, because that was a moment that was for him, you know, and I kind of went up there to like shower my love on him. And then when he just flipped the script on me, I wasn't ready for it. And he just blasted me with that. I felt it kind of like, it was almost like there was like this suit of armor around me that just, it like penetrated it. And I felt this big emotional release. Sometimes it is hard for me to grasp and really feel the magnitude of what it is that we're doing here, and that men's lives are like really changing. And it never gets old to like to hear those stories. And I'm fortunate enough that we get these emails, you know, from listeners of the podcast, direct messages, men in the Facebook group. And then, of course, the guys who we are, you know, up close and personal with in the masterminds, who share these trajectory changing moments. For me, it almost feels like, you know, when we talk about that warrior archetype, and the warrior is the one who subscribes, he's kind of pledged allegiance to higher purpose than him. It no longer feels like it's really about me, that I'm the one doing this. It feels like on some level that I'm being guided. And like there's a will that wants to be done to see these men step into their greatness. And I'm just one of the soldiers. There's a lot of others that are out there doing great work. And I just want to be, I just want to be one of the most devoted warriors of that cause. In whatever it is that's out there that's holding that standard, I want that being or that entity or whatever it is, that energy, to look at me and be like, "I'm proud of that guy."
It sounds like there was a moment that you referenced earlier, a transition from must be teacher and must be structured to no, just become a facilitator.
Yeah.
It sounds like this is really true in this moment, bringing guys on the path, not having to be the path.
Exactly. It's taken a big burden off my shoulders, and it's been enlightening just kind of seeing how every man is built so differently and how we have so many similarities at the same time. You know, like whenever someone says like men don't want to share with each other, or men don't want to connect, or they don't want to reveal their emotions, I call such bullshit on that, because we've got mountains of evidence to the contrary. It's just like our doorway sometimes can feel like threading the eye of the needle because of masculinity, emasculation, and what a man's supposed to look and sound like. But once we get through that, you know, that door, and I think you and I, what we're doing here is we're blasting that door open so many more guys can walk through it in very different ways. Once you're on the other side of it, men are exceptional. Men are exceptional at providing each other support, at being each other's champions, at lifting each other up. And we've seen it time and time again. And I really feel, dude, that this next year, you know, like this past year has been, I feel like a real big foundational year for us, especially with the mastermind and getting two other masterminds off the ground. I feel like this next year is where we go mega, and a lot more men will wake up to what it is we're doing here, and they'll find us.
We're wrapping up here, Dominic. One more question here as a leader. So we talked about the lead up, the design, the people that are part of this with you. Now, I'm curious, after a major event like that, after it's all said and done, after it's over, maybe you're on the plane heading back to New York. What does that feel like?
Yeah. This past weekend was Memorial Day weekend here in the United States. And I took that entire time to really do what you just talked about, which was to decompress, because I didn't have decompression time really much. Like I had a lot of work stuff that I should have backed up. But when I got back here in Memorial Day weekend, I did a mushroom trip. I really like reflected on what we had built and what had occurred and the feedback I'd gotten. And for me, it was one of the most rewarding experiences of my life because I could see the anchors and how impressed we were with ourselves and what our potential is. Like, I look at the five of us. If you were to take the five of us, and I've said this to you before, and we were just our own standalone business, between the skills, the talent, the trust we've built with each other, our ability to navigate, like we're almost like Navy SEALs, kind of like leaderless leaders, that kind of thing. We can always like shift, and we would be a multi-million dollar consulting company. I'll even put this out there. There's a business that's out there, an entity that's out there that actually needs our work because you got man problems or cultural problems that like could hire us for like $1 million contract and we would go in and they'd get 10 times the value. Like seeing what we are capable, and that's not hyperbole. That is like, I believe that to my core. So when I come off a weekend like that and then seeing these other 16 men who have now gotten this new, like they've said, a new lease on life, it's like, what the hell are these guys going to do in their families, in their communities, in their personal lives over this next year? And I am so fucking here for it. It gives me the sense of like, we're about to go on a really big adventure together.
You don't sound drained. You sound ready to freaking go.
Yeah. What's up next? Let's go.
What's up next? I love it, man. Well, thanks for sharing some of those insights. I know I had a lot of curiosity around what it's like to put something like this together and to continually be on that edge. So thanks for sharing. I'm looking forward to what's next also.
Thanks, brother. Really enjoyed your questions. And thanks for giving me a chance to really reflect on what it's like to lead men. And I think the last thing I'll say for the men who are here still listening, don't wait. If you feel a calling to lead other men, don't wait. It's scary. It's the most rewarding journey you'll ever take. Hey, one of the things you heard me mention in today's episode is that in the Digital Mastermind, we are putting structures in place to train men on how to become leaders of men inside of our community so that they can take those skills and start men's groups in their own communities or be better leaders of men at work or in any area of your life where that applies. So we are now starting to take indications of interest for new members of the Digital Mastermind. If that appeals to you, then there is an email link in the show notes, hello@DominicQ, where we are taking only serious men who are very interested in exploring the idea of becoming a part of a group of brothers who are doing deep inner work with one another and also learning the skills that will allow you to start and to run your own men's group if that is something that is of interest to you. And if you are just interested in becoming a part of a group of men who are doing the inner work, the Digital Mastermind is also a great home for you. The link is in the show notes. hello@DominicQ is how you can express your desire. And when you reach out, I want to feel you. No one sentence emails. I want to hear why you are interested in becoming a part of this. And the men who do that will get my attention.